Hello, hello, and welcome along to episode 47 of Beldania. Today I have playing with me Rico.
Hey, I'm Rico. I'm playing Torin Goldenbrand, the Golden Dragonborn Paladin.
I have Jamal.
Hey guys, Jamal here. I'll be playing Kyavo Duskmane, our Order of the Scribes Eonic Wizard.
I have Josh.
I'm Josh. I will be playing Sebastian Belmont, the Abjuration Wizard.
I have Bruno. Bruno, you're muted.
Oh. Hi, I'm playing Rosa. She's a Circle of Stars Druid.
And I have Joe.
Yes, I'm Joe, and I'm playing Hennick Littlefield, the Halfling Farmer and Bard.
When we last left off, we were doing a slow loop, we might call it, and we were looping around a series of Way of the Path dungeons on our way to the city of Valen. Having left Sandringham, of course, we headed to the south, and we went through a... that is not what I was looking for, sorry. We headed to the south and we went through a strange dungeon where reality was painted separate, and you were able to enter pictures and exit them, amongst other things. We crossed over to Galir, where we met a man who basically tried to sell you other people's lost goods and purchase things that you had and then sell them off the property. Mm-hmm. We headed onwards to a cavern full of undead, passing Gia on the way, was trying to dispel the large rune of growth. You remember there was all this corrupted growth where everything was growing too quickly, where nature was trying to reclaim the land, and she was trying to dispel that. Beyond that, you reached the most recent.
The one with the doors with the numbers on them. Like, it only lets so many people through, and then just teleported to the beach.
Yes, we went to the where the path of teleportation and transport portals, in fact. Mm-hmm. And we had approached, and I have done the duty of giving you all a long rest beforehand, mostly because I needed to see how much max HP you had for the gift. You approached the entrance to the where the path of the very first one. A strange time to visit the first one. This one is usually one of the simpler, I guess. Maybe that's a strange constraint. One of the least dangerous to those with a focus. So you are top. Who knows what the hell that is? And it is there in that campsite, sort of, as breakfast approaches and the birds are singing. Pick back up.
Good morning, everyone. I've had quite an invigorating sleep. Seems as though I haven't spoken to you in such a long time.
Feels like a rest of the ages to me.
Sorry, who are you?
I'll give Sebastian a little tap on his head with like a stick or something. Nonsense, Sebastian. Don't scare me like that.
I'm gonna use one of my charges of my tether staff, and I'm just gonna like be in a loop between like jumping through a tree to come out the ground, and just like just a constant loop.
Sebastian seems to be having fun. Hennick.
I'm sure that's going to come in handy at some point, or just distract, I suppose. But how's it going, everybody? As we were traveling, doing some a little bit of grinding up here and turning some of this stuff right back into flour and so forth. And I think I can make us some pancakes for breakfast if anybody wants them.
Pancakes, you say? That sounds
I don't have any great toppings at the moment, but we'll find something.
Yes, I'm sure. Perhaps some berries of the land.
Now that would do.
Surely we have some butter.
I mean, we could make some donkey butter, I suppose, but that seems a little... That's like I'm not going to work. This is clearly a boy donkey.
Would you like butter?
I mean, is that something you have handy?
I could summon a cow.
It seems a bit of a long process.
How about some fruit, Rosania?
5 day
I
wait.
Can do that too. I'll go pick some fruit then.
Cool.
I don't really have anything to offer other than this glow dust that's been sitting in my bag for like ever.
Edible?
I don't think so.
I don't think so either.
Yeah, I'd rather not try to find out.
I mean, I have some nutmeg that's not so horrible on a breakfast confection.
No, definitely not.
I don't think thyme and rosemary are going to be just the thing.
Savory pancakes? I don't know.
You know, I made this up, and literally there's pancake mix in my inventory, I think.
That's what I thought you were talking about.
Yeah, no.
Hey, we got that last session at the end.
Yeah, unlimited pancake mix, right.
Yeah, the giant.
That's where
the
I got
vegan
it.
Giant. He didn't give you any butter, though. Bastard.
Yeah, fair
enough. Bastard. Well, plain pancakes it is.
I imagine, given that you've been camping outside and, you know, traveling on the road, that pancakes for breakfast is a pretty luxurious meal. Regardless, you know, you'll have some sugar.
Yeah, exactly.
A bit of sugar on pancakes is great. I'm sure Henrik always carries some sugar.
Why not?
Can I contribute to the sugar crave or craze?
Certainly.
I'll find like some berries or like even if stuff hasn't blossomed, I'm not quite sure what season it is, but even if stuff hasn't blossomed, I'll pick it up, and as I'm bringing it back, I'll cast Druidcraft on it to make it blossom and ripe.
Perfectly ripe fruit being brought back. Yeah, it is springtime. It's a good time for fruiting, but it's not the perfect time for fruiting. So some of those berries that are just coming in come back nice and fresh and perfect. You know, all have a lovely breakfast. Go ahead and give me a cooking check, please.
Sure, let's see. 25.
Oh, that's a big number. That is 15. Of the max HPs.
Wow.
That is a very big number. So you may increase your max HP by 15. Sorry, I'm really addicted to these sultanas at the moment. I'm going to be constantly chewing this episode. If I'm even chewing, I'm eating and talking. Good berry pancakes do sound quite nice.
That's what I thought.
Not too filling, really.
Not today. I'm going to leave space for lunch.
You get all the energy, but none of the carbs.
Yeah.
I'm on that.
If only.
But yeah, you camped fairly close to the entrance to what you know to be the very first way of the path. And unlike a lot of the other ones, this one is quite clearly marked. You have seen this once before on a tower over the water when you went towards the underwood one. Ooh, bear with me a second. Stormy Dragon Tavern, thank you very much for the raid. I appreciate it. Welcome on in. We are just outside a cabin of time. Just breakfasting before we head on in. As with the other, where the past, most of them were sort of natural cave entrances or even very well disguised entrances. This particular one is much more a case of... is clearly marked. There is a large stone arch outside, and written upon it in Elvish, Draconic, and Common is "Travelers beware, here begins the way of the path."
Very ominous.
I'll end my portals, and then what was it? But like, I'll turn to the rest of the party. I think I found the entrance. Walk right up to it.
You sure that's not a portal? Sebastian.
I don't know. What does it look like? Obviously, there's a sign, hey, but like what does here? The entrance look like?
So it basically looks like a glorified cave. There is a large archway and then what is sort of a fairly small tunnel. It's a little cramped for the likes of Kiavo and Torin, who are going to have to stoop just slightly. It's about 9 foot tall, 8.5 foot tall. And it's quite a, it's not very wide tunnel either. You can perhaps walk two abreast if you're lucky. And it quite steeply turns round and down to the left.
Well, if I will certainly, yeah.
That's what you can see from the outside.
If Sebastian's taken off, I'm following him.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, no time like the present, Sebastian. Like, yeah. He just marches onwards. No care in the world.
You're not going to get very far. As the path twists round to the side, you reach a second archway. And this archway is a little narrower again. And only one person could get in widthwise. And again, somebody like Torin or Kiava would have to duck. And written above this is, from here onwards, your path is your own.
I'll turn to the party as it's getting smaller and just say, I think this one's for me. You guys can wait. I'll march on it.
Okay. For the rest of you, as you watch Sebastian step in, for a moment he goes completely out of sight. And then, moments later, you see sort of like a spectral version of Sebastian walking down the pathway.
Not again.
And just like that, I need to make a new character. Sebastian's dead.
So just to clarify, you see like spectral version as if you're getting vision or a flash of where he might be going.
Oh.
Hmm. Well, should we follow him?
Just to let you guys know, I only have one static piece of artwork for this dungeon. It's going to be all theater to mind. I'm going to put this picture up just because it's a nice image, and we're just going to focus on it in our heads.
What do you make of this, Senek?
Just a reminder, the sign above it says, from here onwards, your path is your own.
Well, I don't know, but certainly seems, we can sort of always take Sebastian's statement as self-important, so I doubt it's just for him, as much as it is for each of us separately. I don't know, probably might be on our own through there, I don't know, but, Calvo, does this, do we remember from what your book has had to say whether this is sort of a easier because it's number one and anything like that, or we should be worried? Or...
Yes, indeed. What does Theseus have to say?
I will want to consult Theseus on this one.
Okay, it's fair to say you would have consulted Theseus on the way here as well, right?
Yeah.
What is known about this way of the path is that it is, if you have a strong mind, if you're strong of will, then this is one of the simpler way of the paths. The key is to focus and maintain your path. But Theseus will interestingly also tell you it's one of the few paths he has to be unable to tread with his master.
Really?
The path walked solo.
Does this mean...
But bear in mind, he was also very vague on the dreamscape one.
Yeah.
It means that perhaps it's not all in the plane of physical existence.
Got you.
Right. Because a wizard without a spellbook would be very, very useless. Mm. That's the only thing that comes to mind, unless it's like he...
The spellbook can exist next to you physically, but not necessarily in your mind, right?
I see. Yeah. Okay.
It doesn't see what's in your brain.
Yeah. Otherwise, that would be very concerning, having to do this with no spells. Oh well. Then I think the question then becomes, we've seen Sebastian go through his arch. Where are our paths?
I kind of expect we all go through here and just end up somewhere different. Or at least think we have.
Well, shall we enter single file, individually, or should we walk in together?
Does it look like there's even a chance of two of us trying to go through at the same moment?
You might be able to squeeze Hennick through with Rosania.
Right.
But considering Chiavo and Torin are already having to like stoop and crouch to get through, like, there's just no space next to it. Pathway designed for a sort of 6-foot human.
Oh, average weight. I thought there would be like other arches.
Nope, it's just the one arch, and it says from here onwards, your path is your own.
Oh,
Let's stick to the spirit of thing and just go through one at a time.
Right, so each of you sees the path ahead of you, and you see, you've seen multiple times the specter of Sebastian walking down this path. Once the next person goes through, for argument's sake, we just say it's Torin, right? And then whoever's next in line, so Chiavo, you will see Torin's specter walking down the path, and then you'll see Sebastian's specter walking down the path, and, you know, alternatively, and then once Chiavo goes through, etc., etc. So you'll all be able to see all of your companions progressing, but they're like spectral. But once you all step through, you see something different. We will start with Sebastian's. Sebastian, you see a long path ahead of you, and you see a spectral version of yourself proceeding down the path. After a short while, the walls crush inwards, and your spectral body is crushed. As you look around, you see a strange big handle on the wall, turnable from one side to the other.
Okay. So, when the walls crushed in, did it look like the path where I'm on and then stops, there's like the path that crushes and then there's another path onwards? Like, is it like that, or is it like a whole...
It was as if the entire path just condensed to nothing and crossed Sebastian.
Even the area I'm on?
No, just that little bit ahead of you.
Right, and then, but can I see past that?
No.
Like,
it's
is there...
all the walls, like,
no,
condensed
it's just
in, yeah.
That area, okay. No. Okay. I feel like the obvious thing is to turn the wheel.
Yep, so as you move towards the lever, you see a spectral version of yourself go up to the lever. Really struggle to turn it. You may give me a perception check to look ahead of you, and or an
yeah,
check if you wish to turn the lever.
Yeah, I'll do a perception.
Go ahead.
Guys, I'm blind. It's too dark.
What did you get?
Nat 1 for a 2.
Okay. Right. Yeah, you don't see much in the way ahead of you. And once again, you see the spectre of Sebastian go ahead of you. This time you see the spectre, as the hallway begins to crush, misty step.
I don't have that prepared.
That's fine.
I suppose what I'm seeing is another option. Is to
Seeing possibilities, you think.
Yes.
And for all you guys, you can very much take that as metagame, please. I don't want to repeat this for all of you. You're seeing watching your own spectre, you're seeing potential possibilities.
I want to see if it actually would kill me, or if it's just a fake.
Oh, yeah.
I will take out a piece of chalk and throw it down the hall to see if it... Ooh, so maybe it needs to be bigger. Too bad I don't have enlarge reduce to make a big piece of chalk.
You can give me a... Maybe not. You've got a 2 on your perception check. You can give me nothing.
It's fine. I can use my orb to like switch out prepare spells to give me Misty Step, but I'll do the obvious thing. I'll Mage Hand turn the wheel.
The Mage Hand won't do anything.
Oh damn it. Fine. Is there a stool nearby?
What you saw in the image was that it was a struggle for Sebastian to turn.
Of course. These frail hands were only for holding wine cups. I guess I'll No, I do have Misty Step prepared. Yeah, I'll just walk halfway, and then when I start hearing a rumble on the Misty Step.
You see in this image, as you get a bit closer, you see Sebastian step on something and the ground depress slightly. And then he Misty Steps through, and the crutch happens, and then after a while, the stone recedes back, and Sebastian is standing the other side, past it perfectly fine.
Oh, then maybe I don't need to Misty Step, maybe I just need to hop over the switch.
Okay. And I guess I'll do that. As you think that, you see it happen. Right? Your character hops over.
Okay. Oh, this is fun.
And then, right, you're getting the idea now. So as you hop over the switch, you see Sebastian edging gently down the corridor, looking a bit tentative, wondering if he's going to get crushed, and carry on walking.
Ooh, what else could I glean from the future?
Is that the path you're going to take?
I will just hop, skip, and jump my way over.
As you come round the corner, you see the specter of Sebastian jump over. Well, you see him go up towards a lever, hesitate, walk back, jump over a depressed part of the ground, and then continue down a corridor, edging really tentatively, looking very nervous for no real reason.
Poor Sebastian could barely turn the wheel. I think I shall try it myself.
Fantastic. As you move over, you see yourself turning the wheel. And you sort of get that image ahead of you turning the wheel. And you hear grinding noises and moving noises ahead. You don't see anything specific.
I think I will follow and proceed to turn the wheel.
Okay. Athletics check, please. I think Sebastian is the only person who... Hennick could fail this as well. Everybody else, I think, is pretty immune to failing this. You turn the wheel with ease, and you hear these grinding sounds. As you look down, you see yourself walking and then falling through the ground.
Heavens.
As you sort of peek over, as you see yourself fall, you peek over, and there's another path just below, sort of a 6-foot drop. As if the path in front of you is now translucent, is that the word? It's partly see-through. Is that translucent? I think it's right. Yeah, the path in front of you is slightly translucent, and you can see another path glowing.
Does Spectral Torrent look pleased with himself down there?
You see Spectral Torrent sort of land a little oddly, and then look around, and then he continues to walk on down the path.
I wonder. I will follow Spectral Torrent, but instead of stumbling and falling, I will do a
see yourself sort of doing a super cool jump, and then you can perform it. So as soon as you think something, you see it happen. Cool. So you jump on down, and the other three. I need you to. I need a marching order here. Who do we think's in third place? It's fair to say Rosalia is probably bringing up the rear. I think maybe we'll have Hennick and then Chiavo. As you walk down the corridor, you see a specter of Sebastian go on ahead and disappear. And you see Torin turn a lever and then sort of do some crazy flip, go through a translucent floor, and land on a path 6 feet below.
I mean, does the lever still seem to be in the position he turned it to?
No. It is in the initial position.
Well.
As you look to the lever, you do see Sebastian struggling to turn it.
Right. Well,
sorry, no, Sebastian didn't turn it. You can now see why this is difficult for me to run. You see Sebastian look at it, think about turning it, and then instead he hops over a part of the ground and walks down the corridor.
All right. I mean, I guess I don't... It's not impossible for me to climb down something. I guess I'm going to look around to see if there's any place I can, Do I even have
rope? The floor is solid in front of you.
Oh. Didn't I see Torin fall through it or something?
Yes, you saw Torin leap through it, exactly. But he turned the lever first, right?
And then you saw the floor change
to translucent and him jump. Yeah.
Well, I don't know why I would want to be down there then. I guess I'll just look around to try to figure out why he did that.
So you look down the corridor and you see yourself, a spectral version of Hennick, walk down the corridor, crushed by the walls. And the walls come out, and there's a bloody crushed version of Hennig. You then see, again, Sebastian hop over something in the ground. And walk onwards.
Alright, I'll reluctantly follow Sebastian's lead. Yep.
And indeed, as you you see like a vision of Hennig jump over and stumble backwards and fall, land on a depressed bit, and the ground crush in front of him, but him not be in that space. And then you see a second image of you making the jump and walking down the corridor. You may go ahead and give me an acrobatics or athletics check if that is the way you are deciding to go.
Yeah, sure. Let's see, acrobatics. Why do I have to tell you every time whether it's advantage or not? I don't understand this.
I know. If it's if anything grants advantage on the thing, it'll always...
I see. 14.
Just roll dice. That is a pass. So you leap over this sort of strange, depressed bit in the ground, and you wander on down the corridor. You see the spectre of Sebastian climbing a corner. And we come to Chiavo. Chiavo, you wander down the corridor. You see Sebastian walk up to a lever, shake his head, jump, walk down a corridor. You see Torrent move the lever, do a backflip, land beautifully down below through a translucent floor. And then you see Hennig make a leap a little less cat-like over the over a part of the ground and walk down the corridor.
Right. So what do I see then?
That is what you see.
No, what do I see when I come in?
When you go in what?
When I go in through the arch.
Oh, you're just going to walk through... Okay, you've already gone through the arch. You've gone down the corridor.
Right, okay.
You've seen Sebastian walk up to the lever, decide no, jump over the button and carry on through. You've seen Torin turn the lever and jump down. And you've seen Hennig jump over and walk through.
Okay. So, do I see this lever still, or is it just not there for me, or what?
Okay, Jamal, I can only describe it one way because there's only one way to describe it. In front of you is a lever on the wall.
Yep.
Okay?
Yep.
You see Sebastian walk up to the lever, change his mind, jump over the button, walk down the corridor. You see Torin turn the lever, jump down through a translucent floor, which is not translucent in your world, and land on the ground. And you see Hennig jump over the button and walk down the corridor.
Okay, so what do I see in the corridor?
A corridor. It's just a dark corridor ahead of
you. Just a corridor.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, then I'll take like a couple of steps down the corridor.
Yeah, you see yourself sort of move ahead of you, step on a part of the ground, move forward, and the wall crushes and Chiavo is crushed. As the walls recede outwards, you see a crushed Chiavo on the ground.
How far down does this happen to the wall, and how thick does this section look?
About 15 foot down. You don't know how much of the wall crushed. There's no way of telling that.
Right.
Because you only see the front of it when it's closed, right?
Yeah. Right, okay. I'll go back to the lever and pull that and see what happens.
Okay. You see an image of you turning the lever and the wall and the floor turning translucent? Do you continue to turn the lever? Nod and smile. Great. Give me an athletics check. Come on, Jamal, you've got to keep up with this. This is a lot for me to hold in my head. By the time we get to Bruno, I'll be like, so-and-so's done something, so-and-so's done something, so-and-so's done something. Chiavo stood there confused.
You don't need to repeat it, I have notes.
I was thinking of two options, I just didn't know which one. Okay,
you turn the lever, athletics check. 15, great, pass. 15. You turn the lever, and you see yourself sort of walk forwards and slip through the floor and land on the bottom a little awkwardly. But then you remember that you saw Torin jump down quite easily and land quite solidly. What's the plan? It's a 6-foot drop.
Nice. Okay, I'll go for it. I'll drop down.
Okay, it's a 6-foot drop. I don't even need an athletics check. You're a cat. You jump down, you land very solidly, and you're in a corridor, and you're able to proceed as per usual. Rosania.
Yes, upon...
There is one catch, so I do need you to listen. As you move up, you do not see Sebastian. Right? You instead see Torin go up, turn the lever, jump down. You see Hennick jump over something and make his way down the corridor. And then you see Chiavo hesitate, turn the lever, and jump down quite solidly. You don't see a Sebastian Spectre.
Oh, I'm yeah. watching.
You only see three. I'm watching, is the point.
I get it. I guess I'll look around, and obviously there's only this corridor, so I'm going to think to myself, well, I guess I need to do this.
Mm-hmm. And again, you see yourself walk down, and then suddenly, bah, corridor crashes, Rosania crushed upon the floor in the corridor. A specter of, not actual Rosania.
I'll think of myself going up to that wall before the crush, but standing in front of it.
Yeah, and you see yourself sort of sink slightly on the ground, and like as if you're stood on a pressure plate, and the wall clutches just in front of you, and then slowly proceeds outwards.
I'm going to think that I'm going
to... 3 foot across and 3 foot wide. It covers the whole corner.
I'm going to think that I'm just going to jump off to the side.
Yeah. Oh, off? What does off mean?
I'm going to imagine that... Right? Imagine that I'm rolling and tumbling forward.
Okay, you stand on the thing, and then you sort of, the wall crushes forwards, and then after it opens, you roll forwards? Is that what you mean?
Yeah.
Yep, great. After it opens up, you maneuver down the corridor. You don't even have to roll and tumble, you can just... You see Rosania sort of roll for a while and then wonder what she's doing, stand up, and walk sort of tentatively down the corridor, looking around, wondering if she's going to get crushed, and continue onwards.
Interesting. So now that my theory has been tested that almost anything is possible, I'm going to imagine the version of myself that turned itself using wild shape into a very fast bird. I'm going to grab onto that spectral version as soon as it spawns.
Yeah, obviously, you can't actually touch it, but you can see the bird just fly down the corridor really casually. Nothing happening.
Okay, then I'm going to then return to option C, and I'm just going to tumble down.
Yeah.
Like that Rosania.
So you step on the pressure plate, and after the wall is crushed and opened, you just step off the pressure plate and walk down the corridor. And we come to Torrin. Torrin, you are on a slightly lower path, and you see a moment where Torrin reaches a junction, effectively. There is a fork in the road. You see yourself go left, and then a while later, walk back. And on the right, you see yourself walk into the distance. Nothing to be seen.
Well, going right is never wrong. And I think Torrin will just go right.
Okay. You walk quite confidently down the corridor, and suddenly it all goes dark, and you find yourself standing before a lever. In front of you is a path that is currently translucent on the ground. You see Torrin jump down, doing a flip and landing down below.
And you
know 100% you have gone back to where you just jumped.
Sense of mind, yeah, okay. Curious. I shall have to follow this handsome fool. And I will once again jump down the path and follow it for however long I need it
to
until I reach the
junction.
You walk
up to the fork in the road, you see yourself walk down and never come back, and then walk down and come back.
Okay, I'll go left this time then.
Okay, you wander down the corridor a short way, you see a big lever on the wall, and you see yourself at a dead end. And you see yourself pulling it. When you pull it, there's a gout of flame coming out the ground. You see Torrin look very unbothered by it.
Yeah, I will follow suit.
Mm-hmm. You pull the lever and flames come up out of the ground, and you are fine. It is a dead end, so you're able to walk back, and once again you look at the paths, and you see yourself go down one and not come back, and go down the other and come back. This time, when he comes back, he looks a little confused or annoyed with himself. Why did I go down there again?
Right side again, then.
Yep, and this time you don't teleport, and you continue on down the path, and we will come to Sebastian. Sebastian, you wander down the corridor, and you see a set of spiral stairs going downwards. As you see yourself step onto the first step, you see them all turn into a great greased slide. and you all the way down it.
That sounds fun.
Please bear in mind that you cannot see beyond your own sight. So yes. The corridor goes round the corner. You don't see what happens to Sebastian once he goes round the corner. Mm. There is no sound. So you're only seeing a spectre of the future, and you can only see what happens in the area that you can currently see.
Yes. So you said there's a set of stairs. So if one's the grease one, what's... I'll imagine going down the other one.
Okay. So you see yourself like jumping past the first step, you mean, and onto the second one? There's one... So a set of stairs just means staircase, right?
Okay.
It's like there's multiple... So it's just a spiral staircase.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, I guess I'll imagine skipping one of the steps. Going on the second one.
Again, you see the same thing happen. The path changes to a greased staircase.
Yeah, so it'll always be greased. And is that the only thing I see?
If you do the first and the second.
Is that the only thing I can see in this room is this staircase?
Yeah, well, you've got to the end of a corridor and it literally ends at a staircase.
At a staircase, I see. Okay, yeah, so I'll try the third one. Why not?
Okay. And indeed, you see yourself jump down to the third one and then pause and hesitate, standing on the stair, looking ahead, as if testing what happens if you step on the fourth and fifth step.
Oh, but that could take forever.
Be having fun when he went down the greased staircase.
Yeah, I'll just go on the grease one as long as it doesn't stick to my fur. I've got prestidigitation to clean myself.
No, when
yeah,
I say grease, I don't mean like it's covered in grease. I just mean like it's slick to
me. Is it like a water slide?
A little bit like
does
that,
it,
yeah.
Does it turn into a tube?
Right. So you're going to go onto the slick staircase, are you? Go down the slide.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, just because I having to like figure out which step to go on just seems long.
Okay. As you jump onto this stair and you start to slide down, you get visions of moments ahead of you. You constantly see Sebastian's shadow ahead of you. And as you reach the bottom, you see Sebastian crashing into a large like bit of spikes that are facing towards you.
Oh, fuck me. then I will I will fabricate the stairs to like instead of it going like that, one of the steps to go up to block me going further down.
Okay. As you crash into this step real quickly, as you fabricate up this step, you crash into it, you do take 3 bludgeoning damage. Because you hit it real hard.
I'm not quite sure I can do that actually, because casting time for fabricates 10 minutes.
Oh shit, yeah, no, we're not gonna. Okay.
Okay, yeah. So no.
We'll just retreat then, a moment. Then, you're sliding down and you just see these spikes coming towards you.
I'll cast
and there's
flying.
A horrible minor image of you seeing Sebastian like stuck to the spikes. You cast fly? Yeah, does
I'll
that
cast,
arrest your
I'll
momentum?
Cast fly.
Go ahead and give me a dex save. Give me a dex save. As you cast fly, you try and grab out at the railing. To your right, and you sort of pull it, and your body flips upwards.
This is the death of Sebastian.
So your hand sort of just about misses it, and then you see Sebastian like hit the spikes, and then you hit the spikes and carry on straight through because it's an illusion. And as you go further on downwards, I need you to make an intelligence saving throw.
Okay, that's fine. Do I spend the spell slot for fire? Yeah.
Oh yeah. You do have fly up, so you are currently like a little up in the air. You're off, slowing down, but your momentum is still going. You hit the spikes, but then pushed through them. But I need a hand save when that happens.
That's 21.
Okay, so you are not affected by that illusion, and you make your way down the rest of the slide, tumbling out. Well, no, you don't tumble because you're flying. You make your way down the rest of the slippery staircase, and we will come to the end.
That was tense.
good. That was the idea. Henning, you wonder. This is hard. So you cross over the bridge effectively of the crushed area, and you make your way around the corner and you see a staircase ahead of you, swirling downwards. You see yourself step on the first step and then slide down.
I don't know, it's the same stupid thing. I'm gonna like toss a rock down and see if it sets anything off.
You notice that the rock bounces on a few steps, and then after a while, like after three or four bounces, sort of as it tumbles down, it suddenly becomes a slide and it slides all the way down. It didn't happen immediately.
I don't know.
What about this spooky mushroom track? I don't like the recorder.
Turn myself.
I'm tracking upwards. No, that's a bit better.
I mean, I guess I would go, so do I even have any?
That's not what I wanted to press.
Wrong
I
button.
Got the goal. Sorry, I was just trying to mark something as red so my Discord stopped flashing up. I just misclicked and hung up. Sorry, you threw the rock down, obviously it became a slide.
Yeah. I mean, I don't even really have anything good to poke stuff with.
Poke stuff like with a sword, you mean?
Yeah, I guess I have somewhere I probably have. I don't think I have like a dagger. It doesn't give me any distance at all.
Oh yeah, your staff.
Oh yeah, it's true. I have got a magical staff. Yeah. That's right. It just gives me abilities. I forget that it's actually an object.
It's a stick, yes.
Yeah. So I guess I'll sort of tap around because I assume I can't like just look and see like is there a trigger, you see
Hennick poke the first step and it becomes a slide and he waits and it unslides. Poke the second step, sip. When he pokes the third, it stays as a step.
Alright.
You then see Hennick sort of tentatively, it's quite a big step for Hennick, so he sort of grabs the railing and almost swings onto that step. Is the first image. I don't know what, you know, obviously I'm trying to guess what character options you have.
Right.
Then you see him again sort of hesitantly poking steps and stepping on them as he does.
Right. But no further down that, turn it into a slide.
Not until he goes round the corner. You don't know what
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Let's see. I don't think I have any tremendous options for making sure I can get down there other than just hop and...
He didn't seem too struggling. He just sort of held the railing and used it to assist a leap, you know?
Yeah. I will, for good measure, have a use. This must be from the feet, the magic initiate feet. A long strider use just to make sure I've got a little... more spring in the old step.
So when you give yourself, you see yourself casting that long strider, and then you cast it, and then you sort of quite easily, you just, your stride is lengthened ever so slightly, and you're able just to reach out and step onto that next step. And as you go down, you constantly see which step is the correct one. But then there becomes a point at which you can't reach a step that doesn't turn it into a slide. It's about five steps. You see an image of Hennick throwing a rock at the sixth one.
Right.
The sixth one stays a step, but you can't reach it with the staff.
Right. Sort of look all around, look back.
Yeah, oh, you see a weird image of you trying to stand on the railing, holding the wall, and then falling off.
I shall... I have... how big a space is that? Like, how big are these... I mean, they're normal... If I was a normal size, it would be normal steps.
It's a foot. Yeah. It's a foot. Sorry, like... not a foot as in the measurement, as in, like, it's a footstep base.
Sure.
Oh, two-thirds of a footstep for a normal human.
Normal size. So,
you could jump, but you don't know whether you'd be able to stop yourself from tumbling onwards, right?
Right. I want to, or at least I will imagine, I'll begin processing this in my mind, pouring some water out of the decanter and freezing it into like a set of like other smaller steps.
You
see, see if the ice triggers it.
Yeah, you see Hennick cast this, and then the ice sort of becomes like a path, and I imagine it's a bit of a stepped path, right?
Right, yeah,
at
yeah.
one point, the floor does become a slide, but the steps remain in place on top of it, and Hennick just keeps on walking.
I would like to try doing that, for at least
You descend the entire staircase on a frozen pathway of stairs.
Who'd have thought the ice ones would be less slippery?
At one point, you do see some spikes in front of you, but as you're moving slowly, it's quite clear that they're a static illusion, as you see that they are not held to anything. You went slightly down a million miles an hour. And we will come to Kiavo. Kiavo, you jumped down. So you come to a fork in the path. To your left, you see yourself walk down the path and then come back looking a little pleased with yourself. As then you see yourself walk down the right path and not come back.
I'll just go down the right path.
Okay. You take four steps and then you find yourself teleported. You're standing with a lever on your right, a corridor in front of you, a translucent path on the floor. You know this is where you just jumped down.
Just looped me back to the beginning. Interesting.
Mm-hmm. You stepped onto a teleporter.
Then in that case, I'll retrace my steps, and instead I would like to try the left path, see
okay.
what happens here.
You see yourself going down the left path, so you follow it, and at the end of that path is a lever. You see yourself pull the lever, and a gout of flames come out of the ground as you pull it. They're very hot, and Carvia looks a bit scarred.
I won't pull it then.
Okay. Do you imagine yourself doing anything else to pull?
Is there any further way to progress through the path, or...?
What sort of thing are you imagining?
Well, where's
so this is a dead end. This is a dead end, right? So the lever at the end of it. There's a grate on the ground where the flowers? Oh, me. Where the flames came through and burnt you.
Am I able to use Mage Hand to just pull the lever?
You see an image of your Mage Hand pull the lever, and you turn around looking very pleased with yourself.
Yeah, of course.
Okay. Is that what you're going with?
Yeah, because at the minute I'm not really seeing any better options.
Okay, you may turn the lever down, you go back and you see the fork in the path, and again you see yourself, this time walking down the left-hand path and coming back looking slightly bemused, as if to say, why did I just do that? It's exactly the same as I just left it. And then you see yourself walk down the right path and not come back.
Okay, so I'll walk down the right path and see if it teleports me.
You proceed down the corridor, you do not get teleported, and you find yourself before a short staircase. And that is where you and Torin Aram will leave you there as we come to Rosania. Rosania, you didn't bird, you ended up walking, right? So you see yourself standing before a spiral staircase that leads down. Same thing, you step on the first step and it becomes a slide. Second step, it becomes a slide.
I mean...
You become an owl?
No, I mean, I just...
You went, woohoo!
Rosania's done quite a bit of questing in the past, so I think this is actually quite an interesting one. She's probably slid them before, so I'm gonna grab a bit of my cloak.
Mm-hmm.
I'm gonna make a fake, like, skate, I guess, something to give me a bit of, you know, a bit of a standing, and mm-hmm. I'm gonna go down.
Okay, so you're sort of trying to slide down it, effectively.
Yeah.
Right, okay. As you come round the corner, up ahead of you, what is it taking so long to skip? The tension was killed by that. As you slide around the corner, after a little way, you see yourself cascading into some spikes that are facing you.
Facing me?
Yeah, they're hovering right in front of you, you're about to crash into them, what do you do?
That's not very nice.
There is a railing, I should mention. I forgot to tell Sebastian.
There's a railing?
There's a railing on the right, yeah. I forgot to tell Sebastian that until I then told him to make a dex save to grab it. If you imagine it's like a big wooden board with like stakes sticking towards you. And you do see an image of Rosania like splatted onto them. Through the back of her head. Quite grim.
I'm gonna like do this in split second planning. I'm gonna think to myself, I'm gonna plan a way to successfully get out of this alive. And I'm gonna execute it.
Nothing happens, you just see yourself cascade into these. You must think of a possible solution. You're visualizing possibilities. Not solutions. There are many time periods where this results in Rosania batting and dying.
I know this is like, she's gonna having a little bit of fun because I mean she could literally just cast dragon form and start flying, but
there's no way to fly, Bruno. This is like
upwards.
Yeah, like oh, I see what you mean. Like just go back.
Yep.
Right. Okay. Yeah. Because the corridor. Just to bear in mind, the ceiling has followed with you, right, on the staircase, because that's how spiral staircases work. So the stairs that you've already gotten down are above you. So there's not much gap to fly. Is my point.
Can I wild shape into an octopus?
Yes. You see yourself wild shape into an octopus and like grab hold of the walls and stuff.
The rail. Yep. Yeah. The rails.
And then slowly edge up, and because octopuses already they don't have any bones, right? You condense in this small thing and you slip over the spikes and down. Is that what you want to do?
Well, Octopus Rosania succeeded, so...
Yeah. The tentacles splat out. Come out. You can't help but notice, though, that when you go to lean on the top of the board of spikes, the tentacle goes straight through it, and you realize it's... You're really annoyed with yourself as an octopus. But then you carry on down the corridor.
I'll stay as an octopus.
And we come to Sebastian. And... Yavo. No, sorry. Sebastian and Tenik and Rosanna. The three of you see yourself standing before... at the bottom of the corridor. Standing before what appears to be a shallow pool. It's about 3 or 4 inches in depth. And it's the width of a corridor. So it's about 3 foot wide. And it's 3 or 4 inches in depth, and it goes on for about 30 or 40 feet. Please bear in mind, Rosania, you are an octopus at this moment. Each one of you sees yourself step into the pool, and then the pool sort of bubble and steam and sort of heat up, and then black tentacles come out of the water and pull you down. You also see... All three of you see each other's vectors doing the same thing. So you each get three images. One of yourself, one of Hennick, and one of Rosania. One of Sebastian, one of Hennick, and one of Rosania, sorry. Stepping onto this into this shallow pool and getting pulled down by these... Sebastian.
Well, since I cast fire myself, I'll fly over the water.
Okay.
That way, hopefully, the creature below won't sense that I'm there.
All three of you see an image of Sebastian sort of gliding across above the water. And as he goes, tentacles reach out and try and pull him down. He dodges a few, but after a short while, about 10 feet, tentacle does grab hold of him, come down, and try and pull him downwards. You then see him sort of teleport out of its grasp further down the corridor, continue, and get grabbed again. Henning, what are you doing?
Well, might as well at least try something that has worked before, and we'll try to freeze sections of the water and walk on those, or at least imagine doing so.
All three of you see an image of Hennick stepping on ice, and then a big black tentacle punching through the ice, reaching up and grabbing him again. Rosania. You see an image of Sebastian flying across and getting grabbed. Hennick icing the ground and getting grabbed.
They're all getting grabbed?
Those two got grabbed, yeah.
Then I will slowly use my octopus tentacles to make my way down, but
the wall?
I won't. But I will be willingly grabbed.
Okay. You see the black tentacle come out, grab you off the wall, and pull you down, and you disappear down into the water.
I mean, I'm still an octopus, so this is actually quite good for me.
Sebastian, you see an image of you and Hennick. And an octopus being pulled down into the water. You do sort of notice in the water, you're seeing an image of three of you fighting a strange black, or two of you and an octopus fighting a strange black tentacle monster.
See, and part of me was thinking maybe we're meant to go down.
You don't look like you're winning in the image.
Combat does seem fun. Okay. I think I have a plan. Mm-hmm. I think. So I would like to I'd like to take out of my bag two tankards. Mm-hmm. And I'd like to throw them both in different directions into the water to see if the tentacles go for both at the same time or go for one and then the other.
They go for the one at the front and they don't go for the one at the back. The one further. They come up and they only grab the one at the front.
Okay, so they do get one at a time.
The second one, they sort of leave where it is. It slowly sinks into the water. On its own.
Okay, so then I'll think about dropping a tankard at the front as I fly past.
Okay. You did see Sebastian teleport out of a grab and get grabbed again. But this time, the tankard gets grabbed. And then you see Sebastian gliding on down the corridor. Hennig, you see Sebastian throw a tankard on the floor and then fly down the corridor. A tentacle grabs the tankard and Sebastian glides on ahead.
Well, I can't fly.
Touché.
I'm going to plan, at least, going over to the edge of the water. Mm-hmm. And speaking towards the water and just saying, look, I don't usually like to do this with magic if I don't have to, but I suspect we're not going to have much of a conversation. So why don't you just relax a while and let us go on by, and I will use Charm Monster.
In front of you, a strange black head actually comes out the water. It's not a spell.
Oh.
You should pass. Yes.
Yes, I would like to.
What?
Well, my friends and I, seems a little grandiose, but we're kind of trying to save the world and all, and seems like there's some knowledge in these caves that we might use in that endeavor.
You would like to be saving the world. Sounds good. And all three of you see tentacles sort of turn upside down and become stone steps all the way across the water. And then the voice speaks once more to you, Hennig. But what of your friends?
Well, you know,
of passing.
I believe they are. The only one I ever have any question about has already gone by, I believe. So, at least found his own way.
Give me, oh, I nearly did his voice. Give me a persuasion check. I was like, give me a persuasion check.
All DM rulings should be done in current character.
So confused.
31.
That's a lot higher than 20.
Hey.
Yeah, all three of you see, well, two of you see yourselves stepping on the stepping stones and going across. Rosania, you see the stepping stones come up and then you just sort of look along the wall. But you are all understood.
She's committed now. She's committed.
Yavo, coming round the corner as you pass, as you go down this corridor, you bump into Torin. The two of you are standing before...
Like in the flesh?
Yeah. In the flesh. The two of you are standing before a staircase that heads downwards. There are three statues on either side of the staircase. It's like four steps down and then a passageway. There are three statues on either side of the passageway. And both of you see yourselves headed down, Torin first, Kiavo second. And the statues come to life and decapitate Kiavo. Specifically Kiavo. They missed him. I've already rolled the attack rolls.
Oh, okay.
It was really sad.
So do all of us see this, or is it just Torin that sees that?
Torin and Kiavo, both of you are seeing these images. Okay, so both of you together are seeing the steps in front, the statues, and then Kiavo get decapitated as Torin ducks below.
Yeah, as soon as I see the decapitation, I'll sort of like stop Kiavo from moving and say, that was awful.
Slightly concerning. Would you like to go first then, or shall I
Would you like to go down alone and see if you get decapitated?
Well, I'm hoping that perhaps we can beat fate, so to speak, and have neither of us be decapitated. Gavo?
Well, I can most certainly beat fate here. I've got a plan. I'm just concerned about how to get you through.
What are you thinking when you're thinking about that plan?
Just jump straight past the statues. You ride the lightning.
Okay. So you see an image of Gavo becomes sort of a lightning stake and straight across. Or a lightning bolt, sorry, and go straight across the corridor. And then Torrin sort of ducking and diving as sword swings are going for him, but he's under one and over another and over another and then just proceeding up the stairs. He looks tired by the end, but very pleased with himself.
Yeah, this looks agreeable to Kevo.
You won't see that image.
I could try to make this a bit easier for you.
Nonsense. Please. Nonsense. I think we should follow this plan exactly. Seems to have worked swimmingly.
Well, it'll make the dodging at least easier to you, I hope. What I'll do is I'll tap him on the shoulder and give him haste for this one.
He wants to make him lethargic at the end of the corridor?
Yeah, don't do that.
At the end of the corridor?
Well, it'll run out for at least a minute.
Yeah, but that would give him, like, the time to...
It'll make him lethargic at some point. He seems quite confident he can make it.
Never mind, then I won't...
So Kiavo, lightning bolt across, and Kiavo.
I'll sort of like, you know, push Kiavo ahead, and I'll slap him on the butt as he
becomes a lightning bolt. You propel him across.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and you duck and dive your way across. These skeletons, to you, their movements are so predictable, right? Because they were holding their weapon in a way like this, right? So they just sort of jerked across. They've not really animated their traps,
right.
And you know, Tara's able to read that. But then the two of you stand before what appears to be a sort of vast, wide open cavern that just goes down and down and down. Across the way, about 60 feet across from you, you see a ledge where the path seems to continue. Looking down into the abyss, you see both of you falling down there endlessly. The point where you just sparkle in the distance.
Nice idea.
For a moment,
right ideas.
You see Yavo sort of gliding as if perhaps flying or being in flight of some sort, and then sort of almost getting sucked down by what's like a hurricane of speed pulling down. So it's there's a definite downwards grabbing force present.
And there's no other way that we can, like, sort of traverse around the side of this cavern? Like, is that
as
like
you,
stone?
As you look round, you see Torrin grabbing onto what look to be heavy vines that are coming down from the ceiling. And although the winds are pulling you down, you're moving from one to the other, sort of climbing and grappling your way. But about a third of the way round, you do lose your grip and fall. You don't see Kiavo even trying to attempt to follow you.
Prospects look grim, Kiavo.
I can certainly make it across that ledge. The ledge is 60 foot now?
It is, yes. What are you thinking?
Is there something over there, like in terms of a lever or something to pull, or any kind of anything that will shut off the winds, or anything that can, like...
You can't see from here. How do you see yourself crossing 60 feet?
Just ride the lightning across it again.
So again, you do see that lightning bolt sort of get pulled a little bit, but it doesn't get too affected, and it dips a little bit, but it does make it across.
Okay, so I can visualize myself crossing the gap.
You then visualize yourself on the other side, looking back at Torrin.
Ah, so...
whatever that means.
Still bemused and puzzled as to what the hell to do. I wonder... what's the length of this force? Spherical dome or sphere, okay, or horizontal. 10 foot by 10 foot panels.
So am I able to evoke the powers of my, what's this thing called? The face shrouded armor to cast Find the Path, to find the most direct physical way.
The most direct physical way. You see yourself sort of evoking the powers of your armor. and you see a black sort of tangible stone bridge descend from the ceiling to fit the gap between you. You don't see how it was activated. That gives you the idea that maybe it's not you activating it. But give it a look around. You can both give me a perception check at that point when Torian, I'm sure, will mention that.
10 That's a natural 20 for 26.
Oh, perfect. Wow. You see a large sort of silver square of stone that doesn't quite seem to fit with the other dark grey stone. And then you watch as Chiavo raises his hand and a blast of lightning hits it. And then stone staircase descends, the stone bridge descends. That's what you both see that.
Did you see that, Kevin?
I do.
Right there. Perhaps you should try to blast that discolored square up there.
Is that over the platform or is that right near us?
No, it's sort of up and to the right. It's maybe a 30-foot range. And it's somewhere over and up to your right. It's just a stone on, like, the dome above. It's like a button, basically.
Right.
But you've seen yourself strike it with lightning.
With lightning? I wonder... Yeah, I'll just fire off the spark at it, then. Let's go for that.
You fire off the first one, it just doesn't quite hit. But then the second one, straight in the middle. And this stone bridge shudders into place in front of you. And... you both see yourselves progress across it nice.
After you, my good man.
As you walk over it, you kind of look around you and you see these winds howling below. And when you get to the end, you see a large staircase downwards, like really long downwards, black staircase. And at the bottom of it, you see, stepping out from the right, Enik, Sebastian, and an octopus.
An octopus.
Excuse me, an octopus?
Octopus.
What's happened to Rosania?
It waggles its tentacles at you from 60 feet away.
Rosania's doing some shenanigans.
I see, yes, perhaps. There's druids, you know.
You both see yourselves, in fact, all five of you at this point. The Chiavo and Torin head down the Blackstone staircase, and each time they take a couple of steps, green flame braziers are lit on the sides of the staircase.
Okay. I mean, I think let's begin treading carefully.
So the braziers light before, like,
as you step on the step that correlates with their
As we step or as our specters step?
Your specters. Sort of when they pass that point, even if they jump that step, right, you just see it sort of as you pass the point, the braziers light.
Okay, well, I mean, they're
right
there.
They don't seem to be doing anything.
Shall we rendezvous?
Let's go for it.
Yes, I will start heading down.
Okay, and as the five adventurers reach the same, well, four adventurers and an octopus, reach the same point where you stepped across this pool, where you come down these stone steps, you find yourself in a vast stone grey and black cavern, lit by the green braziers that were lit down the staircase. There is only one path where none of you have been, and again you see another one of those archways, this one with a snake, sort of, a stone snake, sort of entwined all the way across the arch. And it just says, your path continues. Again, it's in Draconic and Elvish, and then somebody has sort of etched in below in an old form of common. And as you face that path, we'll take a short break. Hello, hello, and welcome back to the second half of Beldania. So, the group were briefly united before an archway? Sure, we're going to go ahead. Before an archway, you see the image of a stone snake riding across it, and it says, your path continues. Somebody has kindly etched it in common below. You can hear it as they typed it out on their keyboard.
Continues here.
would have thought that this was the end of our trials.
Seemingly not.
I don't think that it says that we have to do this alone this time.
As you all stare at the archway, you do see only your own silhouette.
Oh, shit.
I will tell you like frame.
Theory was wrong again, sadly.
Anybody have any particular trouble? Are you all doing all right?
Can I just remind you all that Rosani is an octopus? Okay, cool. We all know that that's Rosania. Great. No.
I think that by now, yeah.
I think that's the case, yes.
Okay, fine.
Druid's doing druid things.
I'll offer like my arm for her to like crawl up so she can like sort of perch on my shoulder.
She's a medium-sized creature.
Oh.
I'll perch. He's strong enough.
That's a big octopus, but yeah,
I think by technicality it's a giant octopus, right?
Yeah, let's say that. For the new ones.
Oh, I just didn't think you could transform into a normal octopus. I suppose there must be a standard octopus. But you could be
anyways. I'll perch. Mm-hmm. Like a backpack.
As you look at the archway again, Torin, you see yourself walk through and your spectre, and sort of the octopus remained this side of the arch as you step through, as if it just fell off, even though it was gripping quite. Deep.
I won't say anything. I won't say anything. I'll let it happen.
I mean, to be fair, Rosalie will also see it, but yes. Do we want to maintain the same marching order?
Fine with me.
Sure.
Okay, we sing in the back.
I mean, to be fair, I think the four of you can make that decision, and Sebastian's probably already headed through that archway.
Fair.
Usually what
happens. Bastion's already at the end. He's just waiting.
Yeah, right. Okay. So, we'll start with Sebastian, because that is the easiest thing to do. Okay. Sebastian, as you head through the archway, you see your path carry down another way, and then you find yourself at, like, a T-junction? I guess, and there are six paths spread outwards.
Is there anything distinctive of each path?
No, in fact, it looks like they've been made to look almost identical. You do see yourself head down all six of them.
And no return.
No, but as you sort of go to head down one, you might be able to get an insight as to what they're like. The first one, for example, is quite a narrow path. It's a squeeze almost for Sebastian. A little way down, you see the out of the wall, big crushing spikes into one wall, and then into another, as Sebastian sort of dashing and trying to get past them in time. I think it's the third one where he gets crushed.
I'll make it pretty far then.
I don't know how good your rolls are going to be, but the first time you look, you get crossed on the third.
Okay, so that's the first one. Do you want me to test all of them, or do you want me to just pick?
No, you can test all of them.
Then I guess I will.
Okay. So you go to head down the second path, and you see geysers of acid come out. And they spray sort of like at an angle, 45 degree angle, like towards you. One of them hits Sebastian's arcane shield, deflects away. The next one, he ducks. The third one hits him straight in the face and his skin begins to melt away.
Okay, third.
Okay, on the third path, you see a gout of flame and then a big sort of ice sort of spray, I guess, downwards. So you see flame and then ice, then flame and then ice. You have a singed ear, a frozen toe, and then suddenly you burn to death.
Okay, four.
Yep, as you go down the fourth one, bits of the ground give way suddenly to huge pitfalls. And then as Sebastian gets like halfway down the corridor, suddenly sucked up into the ceiling. And just vanishes out off into the scene.
Now that one sounds like fun. Okay, number four.
I think that was four.
Number five?
Yeah, as you head down number five, bear with me a second. You see dozens of needles come out of holes in the walls over and over again, and you see one needle catch Sebastian, and at first he seems fine, then he pulls it out, he trembles for a moment, and then he goes absolutely rigid and peels over onto his face.
Alright, and last but not least, six.
Part six, you see Sebastian wander down, and nothing happens. Gets to the end.
Part of me's like, the easier route to sell like Sebastian, just not have to do anything. However, thinking that we're all going to have to go through one, and then assumably that one be closed off, and so someone has to take another.
I'm very impressed with your logic.
Thank you. So that was half my brain, and then my other half is thinking, what can I do, or what can everyone else do? So I will go down path three. And I will, before I do, I'll cast Fizban's Platinum Shield, which will give me resistance to acid, cold, fire, lightning, poison. If I make a dexterity saving throw, which I'm assuming I'm going to be doing.
You're going to make a few, yes.
Yes, and if I succeed, I'll take no damage. If I fail, I'll take half. And because it's an abjuration spell, it will proc my arcane ward.
Very well done, I think. Very elegant solution.
Thank
as you head down, I need six dex saves consecutively. Three for fire and three for ice.
Come on, D&D Beyond.
Can you please click them six times as opposed to...
I can't. I can't do them all at once.
No, that's what I mean. Okay, yeah, right. Do them one by one.
Okay, so first one is a 16.
That's a pass.
Thank God. Okay, next is a 22.
That's a pass.
Nice. Fuck.
I told you it was the third one where he got burned to death. you will take...
No. I will... I'll use one of my lucky die. If I can.
Sure.
Yeah. It's a 17.
So just to make this correct, you take no damage on a successful save, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. And you take half on a fail.
Half on a fail.
So you got evasion up. Okay. A 17 is a success.
Okay, so that's the first three.
Yep.
Next is a 10.
That is a fail.
But I will use one more of my lucky die. Okay. Nice, nat 20.
Nice, okay. Get through that one. It was the second ice.
Yeah.
Reach the third fire.
I was hoping I'd skip the last one. Fuck, I will use my last lucky die.
That is such a great feed.
Oh, you bastard.
It's 31 fire damage, half to 15.
Thank God. Come on, abjuration. So that'll go off of my, that won't go off my
health. Oh, I meant Fizban's Platinum Shield, but yes, your Arcane Ward will also take a lot of it. And then your final cult.
I thought that was all six.
I count 1, 2, 3 lucky, 4 lucky, 5 lucky. Otherwise, you would have taken a different type of damage. So.
Yes! Third, 22.
Does it say?
Come on, D&D Beyond.
You make your way through, and as you turn back, you see a wall slowly lower behind you.
Nice. Oh my God, I'm such an idiot. I should have just heather-tethered myself. So fucking stupid.
Well, you saved it for a rainy day. You've got it for when you want to transport between trees and ground.
Right? Sure. I'm kind of glad I didn't align my train of thought with that.
Okay, Torrin, you enter the six paths. You look down each one. You see... Sorry, I'm just going to recopy these.
Yeah, quick recap. Be nice.
I'm just going to recopy these so that everybody's got them written down. Oh, why does it do this? It never lets me highlight more than one word. Not funny. Okay, so now as you look down each path, the first one, you see these piercing crushes come out of each wall. You see Torrin dash through the first one, duck past the second one, and as he gets to the third one, he sort of makes a leap, but his whole leg gets clattered against the wall. He gets crushed, and he can't get up in time the second time, and shoves you against the wall. On the second path, these acid sprays are gouting out the ground, out towards you. Torrin tries bravely to put his shield up and just charge through, but after the second or third, his arm begins to disintegrate. The third path is closed to you. There is a wall at about halfway down that has the mark of fire and ice on it. It is closed. The fourth path, you see the floor give way a couple of times and Torrin stumble over, but then suddenly you are sucked into the ceiling and disappear. The fifth path, you see dozens of poisonous needles get shot out the walls, and one catches Torrin. He sort of grits his teeth and gets on with it, but when the second one catches him, he sort of seizes up, paralyzed, and falls on his face. And the final path, you see Torrin walk down with no problem at all. You know Sebastian entered before you. You know that one path is closed to you.
I think we should let Kiavo take path six.
I'll sort of like press my hand against the third path like wall. Mm-hmm. And I'll sort of whisper, Sebastian.
Nothing. Silence Ooh. Greets you.
And Torrin will actually take path five.
Lovely. The poison needles.
Poison needles.
Are you doing anything special to try and get down?
No, I'm just going to take it. I'm resistant to poison. I am immune to the poisoned condition. And I'm just going to try to beef my way through.
You're going to sprint or anything? Or like run as fast as you can?
Yeah,
you see yourself sort of walk through stoically. And you get hit by so many that you just... Right. You then see yourself running. And some of them sort of shoot out behind you. But you do get hit by a few. Is that the plan? Mm-hmm. It's going to be an athletics check.
Yes. Well, what I'll do actually is I will evoke my... What is it called again?
You see yourself call out to the power of Bakhmut, and as your body becomes infused and your muscles sort of up a little bit like
you're
hulking, you sort of see yourself charge through. You do see a couple of poisoned needles hit your leg, and at the end of the path you seem to be struggling, gasping for breath, but you are alive.
Let's go with that then.
Give me athletics check. With advantage, of course, because of your...
Just one or a bunch?
One athletics check. That'll determine how many dex saves you have to make. there'll be three. Three dex saves, please. You're not a barbarian. It doesn't matter if you can see these. You can see them. Let me give them...
I can see them.
And it is not...
I get a situational... Out against. Okay. I do have... What do I have?
You do get a situation.
Something to do with my shield master. Yeah, something from shield master. I add my shield's AC bonus to any dex saving throw.
That is targeted specifically at you?
Yes.
That's an environmental effect, but I'll let you go with it. Just because I
fine,
think...
I think
it makes sense, because I think angling the shield towards it makes sense, right? So I'll go... Yes, add the shield bonus. I love that. So it's just the three dex saves. Each with a plus two. So 26 pass. 27 is a pass. 29 is a pass. Okay, dice man. Casually rolled in 15, 16, 18. And done. You notice that there are a couple of these poison needles hanging out your shield that have found a grip in various places. Just sort of pull them out and throw them on the floor. And as you turn back, the wall behind you closes. Panic. As you approach, you are able to check out each path. You note the first path has piercing crushes. Hennick doesn't make it past the first one. He just gets crushed into a wall. You see acid sprays coming towards you, and he's quite small. He ducks out the way of a few. But after about three, you get caught full in the face with acid, and your skin begins to melt. Path four... The path falls away, and Hennick is sort of hesitantly navigating around. And then you see it sort of Hennick upwards. But he sort of hovers in midair and then falls back down to the ground. And then falls through a pit a moment later. Path 6 is clear. You see nothing go wrong as you walk gently along it. Obviously, you know two people went ahead of you, and two paths are closed to you. One with a mark of fire and ice, one with a sort of skull and crossbonesy poison mark.
Can I send the mechanical butterfly with beast sense on it through the portally one and figure out what happens to it?
Okay. So as it drops through the pit in the fourth one, it falls down into... Well, it doesn't fall, but it blows down. And you see that there are spikes, they're all spike pit traps. You see the butterfly can go the whole way, so you see that there are three downs and two ups.
I see.
The ups are sucking, obviously, the downs are just drops, and each one ends in a spiked pit.
Oh boy. Kind of hoping for the poison. I've got advantage on that.
It was actually against paralysis, so I don't think it would have made any difference.
Oh, and I've got resistance to the damage too.
Oh, yeah.
Boy almighty, Hennick does not think he's important enough to take the clear one, but also has no special abilities.
Do you think he's unskilled enough to take the clear one?
Well, that's a possibility.
I'm really surprised by the choices that have been made so far. I did not expect either of you to choose what you did. I see what you missed. I thought Josh would go portals, and I thought then Torin would take the fire because there's a 50% chance of taking no damage.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, very interesting so far. And I did think Hennick would take the poison.
Yeah.
Some weird bardic stuff to try and, like...
I want to... I mean, obviously, we've been here through a couple of things now. I'm aware that if I plan something, I will see the results,
yep.
Or potential results.
It's all about what you think. So it's sort of what am I envisioning happening?
So I'm envisioning the only one of these things that's left. Man, let me look at the list again. That
so
has
the last
like
one, yeah. The last one should have only the four that are right.
Yes, I gotcha. So the one that has, like, defined objects is this piercing crushers, and so I would like to try to imagine or plan trying to shatter them and destroy them.
Oh, yeah, great.
Affects objects.
How are you triggering them to get them out of the wall?
Right, okay, so they're not there until they come out.
Well, they're part of the wall. You could shatter parts of the wall if you want.
Sure, right. Well, it might be easier once they're out and it's not the wall. So I could get a frog or a rat out and try to send him down the way.
Yeah, well, what you will see if you get a rat is the rat is actually small enough and dexterous enough that it triggers them all without actually getting crushed. Have a rat.
Right.
So it sort of scurries on down and the crusher comes out, and you do see that there are a total of four crushers.
Okay.
They do cover the entire pathway, but they don't move that fast, right? So if you're going quickly enough and you're quite small, you can get all the way through. If you remember, Torin only caught his leg in one.
Right.
So they do cover the whole pathway, but once they're out, they take a while to retract.
I see.
And what they leave behind them is like a small wooden hole that push them, right? You then see Hennick shatter one and it breaks off the pole and it's down on the ground. But...
I think that's my best shot, to try to damage some of them and dodge as many as I can.
Just to make it clear, maybe I need to give a time frame. It shoves out against the wall, and then it takes 20 seconds or so to retract all the way.
Right.
And there's a wooden pole behind it.
So I don't think I need to try to damage them?
You think if you could trigger it, you can climb under, or you're small enough. Kiavo or Hennick or Torin wouldn't be able to, but you're small enough to climb under the poles, right?
Right, okay, I see. Yeah, well, then I'll do that.
How many rats can you produce?
Well, let's see here. I've got the
same rats come back. do they obey you, or they... I don't know what the rules are.
Well, no, they don't. So that's then I may have to do something else. But I also have... I also have animal friendship.
Oh, great, okay.
But I definitely do mean it harm, even though it's not going to make me do.
I would say that Hennick is capable of convincing a rat to run in a straight line. Right? You can throw a piece of cheese
in. Yeah. I'm just trying to find the stupid hat again, and I can't find it to see how
the hat of vermin?
Yeah. Oh, there it is. I found it. just got too much junk in my inventory. Three charges.
Okay. So day. Yeah, you can use one rat to trigger the first two and one rat to trigger the second two. Absolutely fine. I love that. There's no checks needed. You make your way through, sort of ducking and diving around. These both rats do make it through. No rat crew.
Right. Yeah. Right, I guess
you didn't mean them harm eventually, really.
Yeah.
You didn't want them to die. It's just they might have.
I don't know if you have much of life down here, but.
And as you make your way all the way through, a wall closes slowly behind you. Kiavo.
Yes.
You find yourself with six paths ahead. Three of them are closed to you, one with the mark of fire. And why does it always fail to send a new message properly? This is me writing a new message. No, fuck you, stupid game. Right, basically, the first path is closed to you, and there is a mark of sort of a huge crushing piercing. The second path, you see yourself go down and acid sprays come out the ground towards you. You turn your black acid-resistant cloak to it, but eventually it wears its way through and you do begin to disintegrate. The third path is closed to you. Go on.
How far down does this acid spray go for?
You see yourself die at the third acid spray. The path is 60 feet. You see yourself sort of spray come up at you at various different points. You
but they're die all in the floor only.
Sorry?
But they're all in the floor only.
They fill the whole passageway. Each spray fills the whole passageway. It comes out at like a 45 degree angle upwards.
Like the walls.
Yes, indeed. They're coming out sort of ground level.
Fantastic. I would like to create a wall of force then across this corridor.
On the ground?
Along the floor. Yeah, it's sort of 10 foot by 10 foot panels, and I can do that for 100 feet long.
Yeah, great. You put a wall. You see yourself put a wall of force down on the ground and then step along it. The acid sprays out and stays under the wall of force. And squirts.
And I'll just cross it.
Okay. And the path, as you get to the end, the stone part, the brick wall closes behind you. Thank you for being the guinea pig, Bruno, and being last. But I think your option is pretty obvious. As you see six paths, four of them closed, one of them has some portals up and down, and you see yourself get sucked through the ceiling on the third one, and one of them is a completely clear path.
Well, since my party has kindly left me the very clear path. Then again, it would be a shame to waste such a neat puzzle. The octopus ponders. I'll go through the clear path.
Okay, you walk through the clear path. You look back.
What happens?
Nothing happens.
Wait, I'll flop my way down.
And yeah, just to make that really clear for you guys, no stone wall comes down.
Oh.
We will hold that thought till later. So, you could walk back down that path, is my point, right? And walk through it again. But we will hold that thought. Okay. As you all proceed round, you find yourselves in individual and different path. Standing ahead, we're going to go in reverse order, so I'm going to stay with Bruno for now. As you come down the hallway, you see this sort of boot, I guess is the only way I can describe it. It's like a sliding downwards, 45 degree angle tunnel that goes downwards. It's quite narrow. You'd have to crouch a little bit, and it's about 4.5 feet in comfort. No, that's not the right one. Diameter. So you're going to have to sort of crouch a little bit. And you can hear hissing sounds down there. You can see little jagged spikes coming out the edge of the chute at different points.
I'll start casting Speak with Animals as a ritual.
Are you un-octopacificating?
Oh.
I've always wanted to use the word unoctopacificating. I'm very pleased.
I'm glad I could provide it to you.
Opportunity.
I think I'll keep using my tentacles to go through for now.
Okay. You see the octopus maneuver its way around the spikes, but snakes come out and viciously bite at you at various points. You note that they are made of metal. They are not real.
I'll just awaken them. No.
Exactly. No, they're metal. I thought about this. Half my fucking party can talk to animals and say hi.
Can I see the end?
Yeah, it's only about 20 feet.
I'll face step.
But can you do that as a pot, as a puss? Wow, as an octopus.
I certainly have the confidence for it.
I don't know what the rules are. I think the world shape says you lose the benefits of your racial abilities. Do you? I mean, would it, if you world shape as a halfling, would you still have resistance to poison?
I think you mostly keep whatever it says. I think it says your game statistics or something like that.
But I think, imagine it's up to me whether that is part of your physiology or your ability. I would say your Eldritch Face Step is an ability in your brain, not your body. Yeah, so this is what the phrase that we need to interpret. You retain the ability of any creatures from your class, race, or other source, and use them if your new form is physically capable of doing so. So if we ruled that the halfling resistance to poison was in the stomach, then maybe changing to a different creature wouldn't power it through. But you're not a halfling, you're an eldritch. I will let you... does Face Step have any verbal... It will not let your octopus talk.
It just says it's a bonus action, you can use it. I'll just pop it in. But yeah, it just says it's a bonus action.
Bonus action, you can magically teleport. Bang! You can see it. Okay. Your octopus teleports down. The snakes do come out and pursue you. So you are now going to have to continually keep at this.
An octopus yourself, being chased by snakes?
As you find yourself in what is effectively like a sewer pipe, but it's made of stone, right? It winds round to the right and round to the left. As it does so, and you are being chased by me, you see ahead of you a large mechanical snake head sort of coming out at you and hissing. Behind him, sort of to the right, is the door that looks like it leads on.
Ah, face step again!
Okay, you're just going to face step past him and run. Give me a dex save as he will bite out once at you.
So, as an octopus, my dex is a plus one.
Great. Are you proficient in dex saves? No, you wouldn't be, you're a druid, so unless you've taken resilient druid dex.
That's a nine.
Okay, so you will get one bite. That's a big number. It's a 2d12. I love 12s. You take 13 piercing damage.
The octopus remains.
Yes, the octopus does remain, and you are able to sort of pull yourself out of its jaws, but I do need a con save. Obviously, if against poison, I don't know if your octopus is resistant to poison,
no.
I don't think you are either.
My octocon is a plus one. I got an 8.
Okay, your movement speed is halved.
Doesn't an octopus have 5 movement speed?
Actually,
it's in water at the moment.
Oh, okay.
It's 5 now.
Yeah, you would
in water, it's 30 then.
Yeah, yeah. And even so, even if it's 5 foot, it's still only half. But he's in water. Your movement speed is halved. You will have disadvantage on all constitution saving throws for the next 24 hours. And that is reduced from your max HP. So the reducing your max won't affect you as an octopus. Just you're not going to heal as an octopus. But yeah, movement speed half and disadvantage on all. You cannot cast restoration as an octopus, friend.
For the next 24 hours? Am I in safe groundings?
Well, you get to the door and we will come back to it.
Okay.
Remind
me, I'm going to fix this.
Kiavo, you have made your way through. Please remind me. The acid, yes? Is that correct?
Yep.
So you made your way through the acid. And you find yourself in what appears to be a sort of fairly resplendent stone corridor with unusual statues either side of the walls. Each one is holding a bowl. There are 6 of them.
Okay, so I'd like to tentatively approach one of these statues while in these bowls.
It leans towards you and holds the bowl up. Each bowl is empty. You see at the end of this passageway a closed set of stone doors.
Can I take a closer look at the statues?
Okay. There appears to be... They're all identical. They're all absolutely identical. The only difference about them is that 2 of them have part of the bowl filled up with stone. At the different heights. So it looks like the stone is impersonating water. but it's at different heights. So okay. One bowl is, say, 3/4 full, one bowl is half full, all the rest are in.
And can I see any inscriptions or anything?
Nope. There is no writing anywhere.
So hang on, is there like one statue with a water level sort of demonstrated and then one on the opposite side with nothing?
Okay, so there's three statues on each side. One on one side has a half full bowl. One on other side has 3/4 full bowl.
But there's only two
that have bowls with any amount filled at all. Yes. All the others are empty.
Okay. Then. This would raise some possibilities. So the first one on one side has half full, yes?
Technically, the first... Yes. The first one on one side has 3/4 full, and the second one on the right side has half full. But it, yeah, one statue on each side. I wouldn't worry too much about the order.
Okay.
Make right. So, you want to add a complication?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure I've got some water available, flasks and everything, and you know, I do my potion things as well, so I must have decent enough ability to get supplies. I would like to, the first bowl on one side is 3/4 full.
Yeah.
I would like to fill the other bowl opposite it to the same height.
3/4 full, okay.
Yep.
It holds its bowl sort of up to you as you stand in front of it, and it holds it there when it's 3/4 full. Still as if it's holding it up to you.
Still. Okay. What happens if I try to move past the statue to go to the next one to see if I can fill the next one?
You go on to the next statue. And as that statue raises its hands to you, the one behind you that you just put water in, the water starts draining out the bottom.
Ah. Interesting. Okay, as the water starts draining out, I'd like to walk back to it and see what happens if I fill it all the way.
Okay. You fill the bowl all the way to the top. It sort of pulls the bowl back to it and the water turns to stone. Its head bows and its eyes glow gold.
Okay. Interesting. So is the other statue with the demonstration of like the part of the stone, is that also?
It stayed exactly as it is, just so each statue is holding a bowl and as you stand in front of it, it raises it to you. The only one that's changed is the one you filled up.
Okay, then I'd like to fill that second one up all the way and see what happens as well.
Okay. The one that has a half full bowl or the one that is full?
Yeah. The one half full bowl.
Okay. So you fill that bowl up all the way. The statue pulls its hands back. Its head and its eyes go gold.
Okay, then in turn I would like to fill all these bowls with water. See what happens.
You move up to the next one and you fill it the whole way up and the statue remains holding it up.
Okay. Then I'll walk away from it and see if it begins to drain.
Okay, nothing happens yet. Just holds it up.
Okay. Can I take water out of it until it gets to 3/4 exactly? Close enough.
Yes.
To
it. And as you do so, it pulls its bowl back down, bows its head, and it goes gold. So you have
the same as the other one?
Yeah. So you get 2 3/4 on either side, yeah, I'm assuming.
Yep.
Yeah, and both of them are on gold, 2 full, bowed in gold. You now have one with a bowl that's half full of stone, and one with an empty bowl.
The one that's empty, you'd fill that halfway.
Them. And as those two go gold, the doorway opens and you find yourself looking down in a chamber, a little like our picture. Sorry, Bruno. I will leave you there at the doorway. Spoiler alert, I think you've just found out what's beyond. and we will move back to Henrik. Henrik, you moved down the crushes, is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So you find yourself in one of these sort of, a bit like a sewer. Passageway, I guess. It's a small corridor. It's quite narrow. And it's about 4.5 feet in diameter. Quite comfortable for you, I'm sure. And you notice some hazy green sort of gas floating slowly through this area. The path is very dark. Do you have dark vision?
No.
Okay, you can't even see. You can't see anything. You just see a really dark passageway ahead of you.
I mean, I have the amulet of light, which I know is most more the haze than the darkness, but nevertheless, I would activate it.
Yeah, great. So then that gives you 30 feet, is it, of light?
Or is it
20 dim, 20 bright, 20 dim, probably. It's probably
that
light.
Sounds more right, because I think it's like the light cantrip. Yeah, it just lets you do cantrip.
Cool. So just there, around you swirling, you see this green haze. Poison.
All right. And we're not, I'm not getting any, like...
Right now, you just see yourself sort of standing where you are, looking into the poison. Until you think of what it is you're going to do.
Sure, well, I guess I'll think of just walking into it and seeing what happens.
You see Hennick begin to sort of cough and choke and splutter, struggle, and then slowly he sort of slows down. But doesn't stop at any point. Walks off around into the distance.
Don't think there's much I can do.
Sorry, I do have to double check, and I know this is real. I'm going to tell you something. Which one of you said you were immune to the poison condition? Oh, okay, it was Torrin, it wasn't you. Yes, so that is correct.
No, I'm just resistant to poison.
Yeah, okay. So you say yourself coughing, stuttering, slowing down a bit, but carrying on.
Right. And I don't think I have anything that can make it better. Checking around quick. No. That's not a preventive potion of any sort. I mean, I don't see much way around it. So I'll just walk on in.
As you do so, I will take a single con save. This is against the poison.
Sure. Against poison. Okay. Advantage on this. 27.
Right. A success. With a success, this is weird, but it's just how it works. With a success, your movement speed is halved, but otherwise everything else is fine. You just can't breathe very easily in this poison gas.
Sure.
And you move your way around this swirling corridor. At the end of the corridor, you'll see a sort of large stone toad squat in front of you. Its tongue is out, and this poisoned gas is emitting from its nostrils towards you. That's where the gas is coming. As you move, its eyes follow you, and you see your spectral self walk towards the door behind it. The tongue lashes out and wraps you in, slamming you to the ground, and it's sort of... You see yourself in combat with it. You don't appear to be winning.
Right. But, I don't know, I guess it's a dumb, it's, you know, it's sort of a dumb meta-y question, but can I tell the difference between whether it's, like, a creature or a trap?
It's a construct.
Okay.
You define that how you wish. It's a construct.
Well, I don't think I ever did, no, I never took hold monster, but I took charm monster.
I see what you mean. Is it a monster? Yeah, I believe that might work.
Right, you know, if it's just like a sword that falls out of the wall, I can't
do it. No, you can't charm that.
So yeah, I will imagine plan trying to charm it, and before I get near it. Now maybe it considers us already to be fighting, but I will attempt to imagine charming it beforehand and seeing if then it will let me pass.
So as you see yourself moving forward and talking to it, you see the vision kind of diverges. You see it first, you do it and its eyes glow golden and it turns aside to let you pass. And the second time round, its eyes go dark red and it lashes out at you. I can't tell you if I'm going to roll a success.
Yeah, that's fine.
That's where I'm at on
possible
that one.
Possible futures.
That's what you want to
do? Well, I mean, do I see anything else around? It's just this thing, yeah.
So you see the door, you see the pathway, and you see this one frog blocking the way. It's not bright. You're in 2 or 3 inches of shallow water, if that's any help. Ceiling's about 4.5 foot high. We're in this tube, right?
Yeah, well, I mean, I could temporarily wall it off, but it's just going to be like a thin piece of ice. I don't think it's going to matter that much.
But you'd also be walling yourself off, right? You got to get past it to the door.
Yeah. Right, it just depends exactly how it's situated. There must be space for me to go past it to get past it.
So. Yes, I mean, well, the creature is, you know, it doesn't fill the whole area. Yes.
So right. But yeah, I will just, well, again, if it's, I could just try to kill it, but then I'm definitely fighting it. I will try to charm it first.
Okay. That is a 14 on its save. Sorry, is it wisdom or charisma?
Oh, let me pull it up here. It is wisdom.
That's a 16.
18 it needs.
Great, it fails. Its eyes go golden and its tongue retracts. And it moves to the side, allowing you to reach the door. The door is where we will leave you. Torek, okay. You went through the poison dart, is that correct?
I sure did.
Oh, come the fuck. Really? Did you? Are you sure? Mm-hmm. Maybe cheeky. I'm going to swap these. I'm not having you have that. That's not happening. I'm not having that at all. So you're going to have Sebastian's. And he can have yours. As you move around the corner, you see a large stone staircase leading upwards. It is grandiose and magnificent. At the top of it sits a golden throne, upon which sits a dead skeleton. You see yourself going to move up the stairs, and the skeleton reaches out and slams a staff down, and the floor becomes ice, and you slide back down. You'll understand why I swapped them when I get to use them. This was quite cool, but I'm not having it.
I don't know, if I was Sebastian, I'd be like, oh, I'll just fly up there.
Sure. Can you not fly? It's one of the few dragony things you can't do.
Yeah, one of the few dragony things I can't actually do yet.
Sebastian keeps telling you, just become a dragon, damn it, what's wrong with you? Let me just play, so I should really give you a little bit more of an image. So you're on a large ground area. There's a big sort of staircase, golden railings up either side, little gargoyles, you know, very grandiose, castly entrance at the top.
So I'm going to try to walk up there at first, but I will make sure that I don't gaze upon the skeleton. I'll sort of like lower my head.
So you see yourself walking up, head lowered, and then you notice the floor turn to ice and you slide down it.
Does it remain ice?
It stops being ice after about 3 seconds, and then you literally see the image repeat as if it's on loop.
I was going to try to like blow some fire.
Oh yeah, this
ice, you could do that. Melt it.
So you then see yourself as it becomes ice. Out of the flame, the ice melts, and you step up the stairs. You get about 3/4 of the way up before he slams his staff down again, and this time repulses you backwards. You see Torin sort of try and hold his ground, but it's like you're being buffeted by a huge wind, right? And at the moment, you're stood in the middle of the staircase. You've got nothing to hold on to, and you fall back.
Interesting. Let's try walking up the stairs backwards.
You walk up the stairs backwards, you're breathing fire in the wrong direction, and you fall on your face as the ice in it becomes ice. I don't know if I'm not painting it correctly, but just to remind you, there are railings on this.
Yeah. Torn is just stubborn and wants to do this.
Work this out.
Yeah. God, I guess I'll do this. I'm going to have to cast haste on myself.
Sick! you cast haste. You see yourself cast haste and run up. And then the floor becomes ice, but you're like so quick, you're just running up the ice. The creature gets annoyed and buffets you, but you leap over the buffet. Coming down the other side of the throne, and the throne slowly turns around. That's as much as you get to see. The image loops. Are you going for that?
Yeah, I think we'll go for that.
Cool. Up the ice, over the buffet, past the throne, turn down the throne, slowly turns 180 degrees to face you as it goes. There's a staircase down the other side. Mm-hmm, at the end of the staircase down the other side is a beautiful, grandiose door. You see yourself dashing down that staircase, and hurled after you are spikes of ice at your back. Maybe you can run down this one backwards. Just saying.
I was hoping that this thing was gonna like repulse me that way, and I was just gonna fly towards the door. Completely on his physical prowess alone, and obviously the haste spell. I will run down.
You're gonna try and weave or anything?
Yeah, I'm gonna try to dodge the.
Okay, so you see yourself weaving, and these spikes coming at you, but obviously you can't see them. So you're just hoping that your path takes you the right way. I will take one athletics check and one dex save instead of three dex save.
One athletics, 19, and a dex save. Ooh, ouch. 12.
You take a spike in the back of the head. That is a big number. Jesus, who was I? Quite a mean person. That is 30 cold damage in the back of the head. Not only that, but it will pin you slightly. You're not restrained, so to speak, but your movement speed is high. You reach the door, and as you do so, we come to Sebastian. Sebastian, you find yourself in a 4.5 diameter tube, and you see grates of flame, various intervals, spurting up fire. Not having a fucking immune to fire guy just wander through it. So it's yours, deal.
But I almost had a throne.
wait, no, that's not... Okay. Oren, you went through the poison, right?
Correct.
You went through the fire and ice?
I did, yes,
so
I sure did.
You should have got the throne.
Yes, but you switched.
I could have given Torin the portals one. I've forgotten about it. Gouts of fire.
So it's just gouts of... There's nothing else.
So there's, like, sewer grates of flame, if you like, that are just pumping up at various intervals on this part. It's very, very dark, but you have dark vision, don't you?
I sure do.
Yeah. The path does wind round the corner, actually.
Okay. I'm not sure if I can do multiple things with this, so if need be, I'll just cast it multiple times. But I will use the metal of the gouts, and curve them inwards to block it using Fabricate.
Okay, so you want to spend 10 minutes sort of casting out all the grates you can see, and having the grates themselves. Okay. Just to explain to you, the grates aren't creating the fire. The fire is behind the grates, and it's coming through the grates. Right?
Yeah, so I'm hoping to just block it.
Oh, okay, you're just going to try and block them off using Fabricate.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can block off all the ones you can see.
Okay.
You see Sebastian, block off all the ones you can see, and walk around the corner.
Okay, then I'll do that.
As you go around the corner, there are two more grates left, each spurting out fire.
Yeah, I'll do it again, I guess.
You have two casts of Fabricate available?
Yeah.
Right, okay. You spend another 10 minutes.
Many casts.
I forget what level you guys are. You guys are stood in the corridor. You stand in the corridor, very relaxed, looking at the two grates of fire. It's a bit warm in here, but that's okay. And you block those off, and as you come around the corner all the way, you see a golden statue of a phoenix upon a stone plinth. Coming from its mouth are flames. Filling the corridor in front of you. You can barely see past the flames to see the phoenix. Just as you look past that phoenix, there is a door behind it. It's the only way to go.
I mean, I hate to, kick a dead dog when it's down, but I'll fabricate to close off the holes, causing...
I don't mind you spending fifth spell slot after fifth level spell slot. Okay, yeah, you close off it. Can you ping Fabricate for me? Can I just double check that this is...
Sure.
Like, I'm trusting you, but...
Not too much.
Okay. I think the definition here that we are missing is raw materials, Joshua. I don't think a statue is a raw material.
I don't like to live life by rules.
Also, creatures or magical items cannot be transmuted by this spell.
I don't know if it's a magical item.
I will say to you, the grates was fine. They are kind of raw materials, really. You can't just transmute this creature. It is a magical...
Oh, it's a creature?
It's a statue, but it's a magical object. It's a fire-breathing statue.
All right. Oh, you just have to make things complicated, don't you? That's fine. Then I will... Okay. I will do something that I've tried to avoid doing, but I see no other way. I will hither a portal below me and a portal on the wall that's next to the door.
Okay, and as you come out, you see yourself coming out that door, grabbing the door and opening the door, and a fire charging after you. I will need one dex save as you reach that door and try and dash through it, if that is the path you choose. Man.
How about instead, if I make the second portal on the door, and I just go straight
through? That just doesn't work.
Damn it! What if I, as I jump through the portal, I throw a piece of chalk so that it tries to flame the chalk?
It burns you.
Man.
You can make
what
it
if
this.
I spin?
Go on.
No, let me still try and work this out. What if I somehow find the awaken spell and awaken a piece of chalk, throw that chalk,
can't awaken chalk
to the flames? Not with that attitude. Fine. Damn it.
31
fire. Nice. Love that for me.
How long does Fistband's platinum shields?
A minute, so it's probably down.
Yeah, it's definitely.
Uh-huh.
31 fire damage. And you reach the door and grab it. And each one of you able to step through the door into your person. We will start, I think, with Sebastian. Sebastian, as you step through, you find yourself on an island. Sort of one half of an island, if you like. So I guess it's not really an island. But there is a lake, and your path is sort of like at the edge of a platform. As you look down into the lake, you see what looks to be Beldania. But it's raining ash upon the land. Rain. You see Sebastian in a cage with magical shackles. You've seen these shackles before. The magic shackles on his wrists. And you see different people, like elves, but harsher. Not even like the wild elves. They're taller than that and thinner. It's as if they're an ancient version or a future version. And they sort of look past and they prod Sebastian with sticks. Point and laugh. And the image in the lake fades. And you see Sebastian sort of drinking a fine wine and standing there while Hennick is telling the tale of the party, and you're being heralded as the savior of the world. Shackled on the ground in front of you, like slaves, are wild elves. They seem to be servants and slaves. And you see the image flash again, and you see Sebastian leaping into a portal that seems to swirl down into a book and dragging with him wild elves. The image flashes back and Sebastian sees a human Sebastian standing in the kitchen having an argument with Mum about magic. I'm sure you remember the argument better than the DM does.
I sure do. She's too protective.
You see the first time that Burlock showed you a trick that you didn't understand, and you trying to understand it. And you see that scroll, the scroll that turned you into a cat. You also see yourself leaping into that portal off of the sandbank. And you see yourself shackled magically again in the land of the Wild Elves. Memories and future paths. As you're dreaming these paths, Bolt rises out of the lake. You see an island ahead of you. As you look to the right and left, you see shadowy versions of all of your teammates, if you like, on an island. There are 6 islands, but there are only 5 islands with people on. None of them have a Bolt raised yet, and they are all looking distantly into the lake. Your vision's clear. The Bolt rises, and you are able to walk towards it.
Sorry, so just to recap, so there was one vision where I was enslaved by ancient or futuristic...
There were 3 futures. One where you were enslaved in a cage while it rained ash.
Yeah, with either ancient or futuristic looking elves.
Yeah, elves that you didn't recognize.
Yeah, sure. And then one where we were heroes and saved the day, but the elves were enslaved. Mm-hmm. And then one where I was trapping myself and elves in a book, assumably like Kiavos.
A little bit, yeah. And then paths including pleasant and difficult memories.
Yes. And then, and there's nothing else to do, just get on the boat, I suppose.
It seems that way. I mean, you could just not get on the boat, but yes.
Should I just turn around? yeah, I guess if there's nothing else to do, I'll just assume that these visions were a gift of the possible outcomes of what our future entails. So I guess I'll get on the boat?
We will come back to you.
Okay.
Corin, you step through your door. I spike the back of your head.
Mm-hmm.
You just stagger out a little while. You see before you this great lake. You look into the lake. You see yourself in a line of trudging dragonborn. Each one of you shackled to the one in front, like the green dragonborn once were in your own land. But all of you are shackled now, one after another, passing through in a line. You see a beautifully ripe, being naturous Beldania that you are trudging through, right? It's fabulous beyond anything you've ever seen, but there are no signs of any cities, of any... It is all just pure green, lush grass and trees. This line of dragonborn goes on as far as the eye can see. You look up, an actual dragon sort of is chained to the ground. Sort of, it's trying to flap away, but it can't. In the second image, you see yourself and your friends given obeisance, if you like. There are these elves that are shackled on the ground on their knees, sort of bowed their heads towards you, almost like washing your feet, sort of obeying. Worship. And in the third image, you see yourself standing before a foe that is mighty, a huge sword. And as the sword comes down towards Hennick, you leap forward to block the blow with your shield, breaks through and cuts you. The images fade out, and before you, you see a memory of your mum cooking in the kitchen, with the first time you had a play sword fight with your father. You sitting there listening to tales of your grandfather and out on the hunt, of Natasha falling at your side, Sebastian leaping in the abyss, so to speak. The first time you fought alongside a golden dragon. And then rising up is a boat. Lake stills. You walk past your charmed frog out onto your island. You see an image of you sat upon an incredibly gaudy and rich golden throne. You are wearing a majestic crown covered in jewels and this sort of luscious, long, silken robe. And before you are hundreds of people, all with their heads bowed. And an old man is looking to you for advice, asking for you. In a second image, you see a large garden. Tanik walks through, tending plants. Looks almost perfect, but then you see, just at the end of the garden, gravestones. Torn Golden Shield. Golden Shield? Wow, we're renaming it. That's great. Torn Golden Brand.
Thank God it's not my friend.
Sebastian Belmont. And then, you know, a little sort of not real one, if you like, that mentions Natasha Islet. So like, as if you've made it yourself, it's not an actual gravestone, it's a memorial to. And then the line stretches out the garden to hundreds of others who aren't your friends. Tending gravestones, but it's a beautiful garden and you're at peace. In the third image, you see these huge elves with sort of grand swords and huge beasts made of earth and fire roar up over you. You sort of raise a sleet storm and you see your friends using their magic their best. You see Torrin cut down before you. And you beg for mercy. It never comes. The images fade and you see yourself first cultivating the garden, turning the earth, getting ready. The plants. You see the stones skipping endlessly against the wood. First time you met the grandfather. All of Natasha. Frustrations with Alessio. The ship and the story that was given to you by Mr. Silvertongue, is that his name? I never remember his name. Zandrak Island. You know who I mean.
Yeah, Zandrak something.
Zandrak, there we go. Zandrak Sweet Woods. Only have to open the handout box, I don't know why. You see yourself sort of standing before the council as not being listened to, I guess. And of people constantly making stupid decisions alongside you, not your party members necessarily, but others, right? And the images fade and the bolt rises.
Get on the boat.
Yavo. As you stumble through your door, you see yourself standing before the lake, looking down into it. You see yourself in a huge tower, full of books, massive library. Much like the image you saw in the portal's chamber. You remember that you were given the option?
Yeah, I remember.
It's the same library, you recognize. Walking through amongst it are other elves. But as you look down to the book, your hands are shackled, magically restrained. And you are dragged away to sit at a table and translate a text. In a second image, you find yourself standing alongside your friends, like heroes. Before you are hundreds shackled, not just elves this time, elves and humans. Shackled before you, some kneeling, slaves. In a third image, you see yourself reaching into a strange globe. It's golden and it has six rings of gold around it, all of which swirls. You see yourself reach in and your hand slowly disappear. You reach in. Your other hand is raised, casting a spell. A huge stone and fire beast before you. You feel your life force fading as you capture it and pull it down with you. Those images fade, you see memories. First time you realize that the master was not coming. First time you entered a mage's guild. First time you opened a book. The looks on the faces of the pride who were expecting this strong fighter saw a puny wizard. First time you heard of the island of Nimlokorik, where maybe that's where you belong. The unusual magics you've seen in your path, Sebastian leaping down into a portal, Natasha falling. The images fade and a bolt rises into the water. As it's into the water, from the water.
Rises up.
Yep. There's little else to do but to get on the boat. Back to Rosania. Rosania, as you step out, you see in the lake, it is already deep red. You see flames falling from the sky, the very earth burnt to ashes. Dead trees sort of moving over and sort of carrion birds swirling. No sign of wildlife for miles. You look down, you see yourself magically shackled. Your hand is outstretched as if casting a spell. In front of you, the last bit of green life on that land withers. You'd see yourself turn and this natural-looking, healthy horse slowly begins to sort of wither down to bones and flame. An elf strides it, rides off. You turn to your next hand. In the second image, you see yourself and your companions returning from a battle. Around you, you see livestock, you see birds, you see all sorts of animals dead upon the ground at the site of the battle. You know, it's like a crater in the earth. You can almost see the line where nature meets death. Large primordial creatures and elves lie slain around you everywhere. As you look down, your own hands are covered. In the third image, you see yourself and your friends carrying bodies, placing them in the ground. Those of wild elves and those of people that you somewhat recognize, whether it's Dandrek, whether it's, you know, people of the Yurok state, etc., members of your circle. You're seeing the number of lives given to save the world. But as you look around, you see two birds rise in a mating call. Over there, a pregnant cow about to drop. The images fade, and you can see instead the first time you communicated with a man, first time you were able to wild shape, the first time you saw the night sky and thought, wow, what else is there? First time you raised your hand and actually cast magic. The first time you healed someone. First time you took flight. First time you met these guys. It was a memory. As the memories fade, the boat rises out of the water. You're able to get on it. I'm afraid we're not going to finish session. We're going to have to stop there, I think. It's going to take about 20 minutes to get to the end. We need to stop, Rico. We do, right?
Unfortunately, sorry.
No, that's great. That's great. We're going to pick up at this point next week. But I will give you a brief preface. As you step onto that boat, you're in the toughest struggle you've ever had. So I don't know what that is for your characters. I have to ask you. But it takes you back to a time of a previous struggle. You're going to relive it to cross the map. We'll find out what those are next episode. Because for now, it is time for a timeless tradition of MVPs. As we will end there. And I will start where I finished, which I believe was with Joe.
Yeah, octopus. I always like a good octopus. I think they're just a good animal. They can, although obviously as we remembered, they're not so fast on land. Like, they can do both, and it's fun, and they're just weird, and I like having an octopus around. That's all.
That's what you pulled from this session.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of good stuff, but I'm not going to take the easy ones just because I go first.
You like the octopus, I love it. Who is next? Bruno.
I mean, obviously, being an octopus is pretty cool. I'm probably going to do this more. I think Rosania is just tired of everybody being doom and gloom. So yeah, let's spice it up a little. I think I really enjoyed the fact that Sebastian just ignored everyone and went straight on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, rightly so.
I felt like it was very much in character.
Mm-hmm.
He's always very isolated in this kind of stuff. So yeah.
Josh.
So this was definitely my favorite way of the path. It was so, so cool. And really fun to see how everyone like tries to figure out how to get past their obstacles. It's very cool. Yeah, it was a bit of a, like, a sudden turn, though. It's like, oh, these fun, dangerous puzzles. And then we turn the corner, it's like, death, slavery, sacrifice. Like, Jesus Christ, what a twist. Mm-hmm. And that was, like, 1 second, I, like, my eyes glazed over, like, just for a bit, like, literally a second. Now, as I came back, I just hear James going, over there's a pregnant cow. I was like, what have I come back to? What's going on? Yeah. But, yeah, really, really like this session.
Jamal.
Can you do that as a puss?
I did say that, didn't
as a,
I?
As did a say puss. That,
yeah, that was a. That was a. I'm just gonna let you have that outreach.
Yeah, similarly to Josh, I really thought that it was interesting to see everyone's like unique and sort of interesting solutions to their respective problems. I think my favorites were obviously the octopus. That was genius. And I actually thought that Kiavo turning into a ball of lightning was quite clever. I was like, how is he going to do this? He can't fucking fly. And he's like, well, I can just, you know, shoot myself over there. And I was like, oh, fair enough, actually.
Yeah. I love that. It was great. Yeah, I really like some of the unique solves. I loved the ice stairs on the real stairs. That was really fun. I loved the wall of force blocking the acid. That was great. I really like the idea that Torin was just going to show how manly he was. I'm just going to do athletics. I don't do anything else.
That was the other thing. Everyone had these like great magical ways of like problem solving. And I'm just like, I can just run really fast. But
what was also wonderful is that like all of these creatures at the end that you faced, like, could all be spoken to. They could all be just spoken to. Talk to them, explain why you're there, etc. There were paths that we didn't go down, especially in the early one. There was a second path for Rico and Kiavo. I think maybe I didn't make it obvious enough. But if you didn't...
Was it going backwards?
Yes, if you had have gone like the other way, there was a magical door that you could find. And then you
I thought of that. I was like, should I just like go back like the way
Because
I
you dropped, right? You didn't actually walk that way. You dropped that way, so exactly. There was a path back under. I really like splitting you guys up, bringing you together, splitting you up again. I really enjoyed that you guys really rolled with it and seemed like genuinely enthusiastic about other people's solutions. Obviously it draws it out when I separate you, but I think it really adds to the drama. I had planned on you guys going through this dungeon at like level 4, but it kind of translated. I scaled up the damage obviously on the traps, right? Maybe a little too far on a couple of them. I just took them from Code of Cold and Fireball, and then I realized that actually that really hurts if you get hit by something more than one of them. But yeah, I suppose that's how it is. But apart from that, I left it exactly as it was when it was written at the beginning. And obviously the idea was that you would get these visions of the future back at the beginning when you first started hearing about this Troubles of the World. But it's kind of nice to do it now. I like it, and that's why I added the memories. So I really, really enjoyed this. I do have a silly MVP. I liked it when Rico said, I'm going to follow the handsome fool, meaning his own specter. That was really cool. And also when you put your hand out again, Rico, and try to converse with Sebastian's, you know, past gone self.
Yeah,
I really enjoyed that. But yeah, that is where we're going to end. If you guys would like to say goodbye.
Goodbye.
It falls to me to say thank you very much to Stormy Dragon Tavern for the raid. Ben, I revoked your points as we had no checks left in the raid, but we will, I'm sure we will be able to use them again in future. And we will see you soon.